Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Expressing My Loving Self in the World presentation, Jesus and Mary encourage us to have the courage to express the gift of our own loving self to the world, while personally living in harmony with God's love and truth, and outline some of their plans for future assistance group. Recorded on the 11th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
How are you doing? Some of you have already gone home. But you're still here in body, you know. It's like your body's still here, but you've you've gone. Just as an aside, how would you have measured your mood over the 6 days? I mean collectively, It's sort of got, the first hour was a bit low, right, wasn't it? Started talking about pain right from the outset. It's pretty harsh. And then we got into the facade, and I feel many of you started connecting to what caused your facade, and many of you started having a real nice, I don't know, sort of a loving feeling about, you know, oh, this is who I am and this is what got created. Started to feel like, you know, you could have some compassion for it. Still haven't accepted it, but have some compassion for it. And so remember, the first talk was the creation of my pain. And whenever we talk about pain, you get pretty complicated. So that and there's a reason for that, and that's because we've been taught to desensitize to pain, and many of you still have a strongly developed will to desensitize yourself to pain. And so much so that you don't even want to know how it got created. That's how strong the will is to desensitize yourself to it. But then when we got to the second talk, you say which was the creation of my facade, you know, at the start of the talk, I felt a lot of uncertainty, still felt quite self-judgmental. But then as we proceeded through the talk and you started to get the feeling that I was trying to get across to you, and that is that feeling of understanding how bad your life was as a child. Most of you have little understanding how bad it was in terms of how it's affected you badly. And it's not like your parents tried to make it bad or anything. In many cases, parents try to do the best they know how to do. And let's be frank, for the majority of parents, there's no education whatsoever of how to be a parent. So, you know, you really, you know, I don't know if you, those of you who've had children, you're sort of, you know, blundering around in the dark, aren't you, most of the time, with what to do. You don't understand why your children are reacting the way they are. You don't understand the relationship between your emotions and theirs. Very little education when it comes to child rearing. And as a result, my parents often try their best, and I'm not saying all parents do, because there's quite a lot of parents who don't, but so often they do try their best, but they still do a lot of damage. And having some compassion for that facade that got created to try and compensate and survive the damage. So by the end of that day, my feelings were, a lot of you are connecting, you're starting to have a little bit of compassion. Very nice feelings that you're having there. And then you didn't sort of know what to expect the next day when we talked about accepting the facade, but that made you, many of you, feel even a bit better again, because you started saying, oh, this is my problem. I've been trying to ignore it and circumvent my life around it and do whatever I can to make out I don't have one, which is just create another one. And as a result, you know, that's causing a lot of trouble for me, and starting to see that, this is a very important phase, this, accepting my facade. Very important thing to do. And we talked in the feedbacks about some of that, didn't we, about how important it is to accept your facade and how important it is to get out of denial and into this place where you can see what's going on. It's a first part of a self-awareness developing. So that was the end of the second day. We're feeling not too bad. Did that be right? Yeah. And some of you even felt enthusiastic. Isn't that lovely when you express it, that of yourself? Yep. If we can have phones turned off, thank you. And so then we're hitting the third day. So the third day, after a day's break, Mary does some review for you, reminding you of the day. Pretty good comments in the review. You could connect to many of the things that were said. You still remembered many of those things. And then we get to the governing emotions. Now, how would you feel you went with that? It was a bit tricky, wasn't it? There was a bit sort of, now I'm starting to get a little bit technical in some ways about what's controlling you. But we had to introduce it because we needed to talk about how global emotions, you know, all-encompassing emotions affect whole areas of your development. So we needed to talk about that because once you deconstruct your facade, you're getting into this, some basic global emotions. And even to deconstruct your facade, you need a global emotion of faith to deconstruct your facade. So we needed to discuss how there's some emotions that control everything you do. Positive emotions and emotions that are out of harmony with love as well. And so I feel for many of you, you were interested in a topic, but not yet personally engaged so much with it. And then when we talked about God's conception of pain versus your own conception of your current pain, many of you had a bit of a struggle there seeing that initially, and then you realized, oh, so what you're really saying is that my current pain is the biggest pain that I've actually got. And that's what we're saying. It is. The law of compensation is working against you, trying to correct you right at the moment, and the current pain you're in is the largest pain you actually have. But the problem is we're desensitized to it, so we don't see it that way. And in fact, we almost want to see it differently, because if we see it as little and we see the terror as big, it means that we can have more justification of not dealing with the terror. Right, so that was an interesting thing. And then we got into deconstructing the facade, and now it's sort of plateauing out a bit in terms of our enthusiasm, isn't it? Now we're starting to see, well, how do we go about this deconstruction process? And this is where we started asking questions. So you're saying that I haven't deconstructed my facade, and I'm going, yes, so you haven't, because you still keep presenting it, so you mustn't have deconstructed it. And deconstruction process requires going through a whole heap of intellectual awareness, a whole heap of emotional awareness, and quite a lot of exercise of two primary will-based desires. The will-based desire to feel all of your emotion, and the will-based, and including the emotion of terror, and the will-based desire to develop faith. And both of those two desires are critical for our progress. And then we started to get to the releasing the pain. Now we're starting to go downhill a bit now. Have you noticed that? The releasing pain, and that's because there's a number of reasons. Firstly, whenever I talk about pain, you don't like it. Right, so that's one reason. Not interested in it, you don't like it. But I find pain very interesting because pain determines beliefs. Pain determines concepts of love. And so if you can connect to pain, you can connect to what your false beliefs and what your false concepts of love are. And this is very powerful. Very powerful if you want to have a relationship with God, and very powerful to help you look at what's blocking the flow of pain coming out of you. And what I love about the flow of pain, and to be honest with you, it is one of the most critical things that you're going to face in your development, this flow of pain out of you. And it will also be the time when you feel relief. You'll feel a lot of relief as it comes out of you. And afterwards, it's just like, yeah, you feel completely different, and your attractions change, of course. So it's a very good place to be. And then yesterday, I feel most of you are quite enthusiastic about yesterday, yes? So it sort of did a bit of a dip there, and you're just enthusiastic about the fact that you're learning about yourself. And I feel that, you know, we probably could have had 2 or 3 days of that, and you guys probably would have like those 2 or 3 days without getting too overwhelmed by it and so forth. You can see there's a lot of material there, and we only barely scratched the surface of it. You want to say, babe?
I think we had a little dip around the soulmate section though.
Of course, yes. You know, when I started talking about the whole self, that's when we start to really stress out a bit now, because we know, I've been ignoring that, right? And most of us have, let's face it, been ignoring that issue, trying to tell ourselves it doesn't matter. If we're in a relationship in particular, we tell ourselves it doesn't matter. And if we're single, we tell ourselves it doesn't matter. And we do that for a lot of reasons, but it's an essential part of your future progression and your future life. So it's certainly something you want to address and deal with as soon as you can. But we focus there on God, what God's done, and as a result, your general feelings lifted a bit there. But today we focus more on what you need to do. And that's what happens then, isn't it? So here we go again. My responsibility. Now, if you examine the pattern, any time that I talk to you about what is somebody else's responsibility, your mood lightens. But every time I talk to you about what is your responsibility, your mood darkens. So there's one of your primary addictions, wanting someone else to be responsible for what's inside of self. That makes sense to you? You can see the general mood. Now, what happens with spirit influence during this period here, particularly this day and this day, this point, which is in the first day still, and this point in the second day, there was some pretty good abilities for spirits to help you in those two places. You were pretty open, right? And they could help you in this aspect of helping you feel that you need to be more compassionate with yourself. But by the time we start getting here again, you're starting to close down again, and then they have less influence on you. And then the darker spirits come and they have more influence on you. Does that make sense? And as a result, the mood darkens as well around you, as well as inside of you. And most of it happens because we're still quite resistive to taking personal responsibility for our life. And that's what this course has been about this week. Taking responsibility inside of yourself to develop your loving self. Stop relying on other people doing it for you. Stop relying on magical thinking that someone else is going to come along and wave a magic wand and everything's going to be better for you. It's not going to work that way. There's things that you'll need to choose to do for yourself. The thing I love about it is that it's not only right that that's true, that you have to do things for yourself, but also it's the only way it can work because you are the only person who has control of you. So it's actually the only way it can work. You, although you have all this pain in you now and you have all this facade now, only you can choose to remove it. Nobody else can do that for you. And God will help you, but God can't do it for you. Your will is required in this process. And God's interested in sincere will, not just in talking about things. So what's going to prove your sincerity, really, at the end of the day, is what you do about what you've learnt this week. Can you see that? What you do about it's going to be pretty important. And so for a moment, just a few moments, I'd like to talk to you about what you can do to once you leave here, what you can do. There's probably four different things I'd like to mention to you. The first thing is having courage. Now, courage is one of these interesting things that, you know, we define it as courage, but to me, it's not really courage that is required. It's the desire to do things God's way and to live in harmony with God's truth and God's love that gives me courage. That's what, it's my desire to do things in harmony with God's truth and God's love that draws me into doing things even under the most difficult or extreme of circumstances. And I feel that's what will also help you have courage. So the qualities of faith are very important to courage, and the quality of desiring truth at all costs. Getting inside of yourself a feeling, getting to have a feeling where you desire God's truth no matter what happens to you, no matter what, how you're attacked, no matter how your life turns out, you're going to focus your attention on God's truth and getting God's truth. And that's going to lead you through so many things if you have that quality of desiring God's truth at any cost. The irony is, the cost will only be all of your creations that are out of harmony with God's laws. Unfortunately, that's probably most of what you've done up to now. Does that make sense to you? Because God's laws are all about deconstructing any creation that has been created that has been out of harmony with the law, out of harmony with love. And the majority of our creations are out of harmony with love. And so they will be destroyed. God purposefully wants them to be destroyed. So they will be destroyed. And what you're left with is any creation you have engaged that's in harmony with God's love. That will be developed and it will grow. And some of them, it'll grow into immense, like immense things that are, that if you engage it that way, many of your creations will last thousands of years on earth. You won't even be here, but your creations will still be here if you engage them in harmony with God's love, with God's laws. But if you engage your creations out of harmony with God's love and God's laws, sooner or later they're going to get destroyed. No matter how extreme they are and how big they are, they're all going to get destroyed. Right? Because they're out of harmony with God's love and God's laws. In the past, there's been empires that have been so large they've encompassed almost all the earth. And because they were out of harmony with God's love, you don't even know of them now. We don't even see them anymore. Right? And yet at one point in time, historically, they encompassed almost the entire known world of mankind. Right? God's love and God's laws destroy creations that are out of harmony with love. So we've got to be comfortable with that process. But where we're not comfortable is this creation, which is what we think is most of ourselves, this creation of sin, creating pain, creating false beliefs, creating global terror, creating facades, creating addictions, creating denial, this big monster of a creation, which is our and humanity, society and parents' creation all combined together, it has to be deconstructed. And all of God's laws are going to help you deconstruct. So that's a good thing. God's laws are helping you do it. But it just depends on how you use your will, whether you're going to use your will in harmony with God's laws or not, to whether it will be deconstructed. This is what, you'll need courage to do this. You'll need courage because the world wants you to keep it. The world you live in wants you to keep it. And at some point, you're going to have to learn to live in the world without being a part of it. And if you can think about it, those of you who have a religious background, that's exactly what I said to the first century Christians, is it not? They have to learn to be in the world without being of it, without being a part of it. And this is what you need to do. Being a part of it is you're afraid of it. You want to conform to it. All of its false beliefs and false definitions of love, you absorb in that place. But to deconstruct this, you're going to have to get rid of those beliefs and definitions of love. That's going to take courage. It's going to take a really strong desire within you to go against the flow. To go against the flow. Paul, you would like to ask?
My question is it your, I'll just try to word this, your love of God, is that mainly driven by you know the benefits that will come from that?
No, my love of God is mainly driven by knowing God's character and loving it. So it's not driven by selfish desires. I love God because of God's character. Like, isn't that why you'd love anyone? But the question is interesting, Paul, because it shows that most of us probably have personal reasons for loving God rather than thinking that it's all about God's character and nature. And this is why in the last discussion of the whole series we're talking about our love for God, because it's our love for God actually that will drive the majority of our behavior at some point in our future. But it's, I love God because I know God's character and nature. I don't love God because of what God's given me, although what God's given me is lots. I love God because God's character and nature is the most wonderful and beautiful character and nature that you or I or anybody who will ever experience. That's why I love God. Right? At the moment, many of you, for many of you, love of God is just a personal thing about what God's going to give you. And that does need to change, obviously. But let's look at the next issue I wanted to raise with you. Obviously, if you have some courage, you'll start making plans, loving plans, and actions. There's so many things, you know, like I can think of so many businesses and so many things that can be done where you could create loving action, loving plans and build things in harmony with love and benefit the world and also have a benefit to yourself, right? But even just the loving plan to accept your facade, that's a loving plan. The loving plan to get out of denial, that's a loving plan. Anything that's going to make you less unloving is going to be a loving plan. And remember, the process we've gone through this week is a whole lot of things to reduce the unloving and some things to increase the loving. We had two sessions on recognizing the unloving and removing it, and then we had a session on recognizing the loving and trying to develop it. Right? And both things are a part of the plans you can make. So you can actually make plans to get out of denial and so forth, and you can also at the same time make some plans to be yourself in the moment. You can. And notice all your fears and everything that come up by when you're not being yourself. You can make plans in both directions at the same time, can't you? And take action on those plans. But again, it's driven by you, you see, because remember, part of the things we discussed were having this aspiration rather than always needing somebody to come along and inspire you to do it, rather than needing someone to sort of, it's almost like you need someone to kick you in the backside sometimes, isn't it? And we don't need that. That's a negative way thing driving us. What we need, and then other times it's like someone's holding a stick, you know, in front of the donkey type of thing, and we're just going along waiting for the carrot, right? But that's inspiration from someone else too. We need to stop being the donkey waiting for the carrot and start being the paddler who paddles his own boat, right? And takes personal action through his own desire rather than somebody else's. So don't be afraid of making some plans, trying to carry them out, doing some experiments. Remember that everything you do to deconstruct this facade is a loving plan. Right? Focus on one thing at a time. Don't give yourself lots of jobs to do. You know, we talked about that earlier with Nikki, right? Stop thinking down at this terror when you're up here at denial. Stop thinking down here in this terror when you're up here at the addictions. Focus on where you're at. Focus your attention on that, work on that, make some loving plans to deconstruct that. Right? Know where you're at, and we talked about how to measure where you're at in the group, so you know where you're at. Do some action, take some action, personal action that you define for yourself. Don't need approval from other people or anything else, you just need to desire to do these things for yourself. The more you build your will to do these things, the stronger your will gets. And by the time you've passed, your will is going to be so strong, no one can shake you from your desires and plans. That's what you want. And the only people that can influence you away from what you desire and plan are people who are even in more love than you, and they know how to do something more loving than you. That's the only people that can influence you. That's all you really want, isn't it, at the end? So engage the process through your own decision making, your own choices, and your own planning and your own action. Yeah. then I said in the previous group too that we need to make sure that we're continuing to act in harmony with love. And I can't sort of emphasize that enough. And remember, in the previous discussion I had with you, we said that acting in harmony with love is a lot about things like being yourself right now, doing the loving thing right now. If there's a problem with somebody that's out of harmony with love, particularly with your partner or your children, deal with it right now. Address what the cause is right now. If you don't know the cause, try and find out the cause. If you can't find out the cause, it's because you don't want to know. So ask yourself what you don't want to know. Why don't you want to know? Do some work on the issue rather than relying on some magical wand being waved by some event or situation that does all this for you. Act in harmony with love. If you know love would do something, then don't do anything other than that thing. If you don't feel like doing that, then first address the fact that you don't feel like doing it by analysing the emotion first, because that would be loving, to analyse the emotion before you act. Right? Let yourself do these things. And then, like, also, I think something that's been missing a lot is assisting others, loving assistance of others. Many of you engage in pulling down each other. Well, and partly you can see because you haven't accepted your own facade yet, so you're pulling down yourself. So, of course, when it comes to noticing what somebody else does, you pull down them too. Right? That's not helpful or suitable. There's a difference between pulling down a person and just saying the truth, but many times you have a feeling of judgment towards another person. Right? That's not helping them. That hinders them. There's a difference between saying the truth and are you certain it's the truth? Because if you're not certain it's the truth, should you be saying it? Probably not, right? And how can you be certain it's the truth if you're way up here in your own facade? It's going to be pretty hard to be certain of truth up there, isn't it? You're going to have to do a fair bit of work before you're certain of truth. But you can still do things to think about, okay, this person needs some help. What can I do practically to assist the person? What can I do practically? Not pull them down, not attack them, not distress them in any way, but practically what can I do to assist them? You know, I notice the person's a bit down about the way. What can I do to, you know, help them with some faith, to get some faith back so they, you know, get themselves straightened out again, type of thing? What can I do to assist them? A lot of times we watch a train wreck happening, whether that train wreck be the person accepting negative influence from other people, or the person sort of accepting untruth from the world, or the person's having less and less faith, and we watch the train wreck happening, we say, oh, it's none of my business. If you love them, like, you can at least offer your assistance. You just say to them, look, be honest with them. I'll notice that you're not feeling much faith lately. Is there anything I can do to help? And they might rave on a bit about how it's all this and it's all rubbish and rah, rah, rah. And you say, well, these are all emotions. You know, Jesus told us we're going to have those emotions. But then they might say, oh, I don't want to hear any more about it. Fair enough. But at least you've tried to give them help and assistance, you see. And many of you have been, like, feeling like, all this has got to be gone alone. I've got to do it all alone. And sure, there's a lot of work that has to be done alone, isn't there? Because it requires our will. But we can encourage each other rather than discouraging each other. We can help each other rather than hindering each other. You'd like to ask Christiana?
When does loving assistance of others, helping others, switch over into rescuing or sacrificing?
Well, obviously it depends very much on our addictions.
Yeah.
So, you know, helping others is going to require me to be quite sensitive to my own addictions. Mm. Why am I doing this? Am I doing this for me so that I can get a good feeling, or am I actually doing it motivated because I want to help that person? What am I going for a reward? You know, so there's people, for example, who's been channeling or doing other things, but they're really just doing it for a reward. they want approval from someone, or they want money from someone, or they're hoping they'll get money from somebody or something. You know, we've got to look at our motivations. If our motivations are pure, we'll be doing things because we love people, not because of what they'll give us. Some people will attack us even when we tried to help. And you won't go away and say, I'll never do that again. If you had a right, loving motivation, why would you never do it again? Mm. Even if you are attacked, why would you never do it again? It makes no sense. The only reason why you're choosing to not do it again is because you wanted something in return. So you have to examine that. What did you want in return? So if you're going into a situation wanting things in return, of course it's not going to work very well.
Sure.
Yeah. You know, it's not going to be helpful either, is it? Because all you're doing is feeding your own addiction. How can that be helpful? It's never going to be helpful.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. So these are things that we can do. And then obviously there's other things we can do too. But I just wanted to help you to be aware, to have more, you know, at the beginning of this, of day one, we started to talk to you about having compassion for yourself, did we not? And many of you got that message. And what I'm saying now is have compassion for others. All of us are at different places. We've all got different things to deal with. Have compassion for each other about it. Stop thinking that they should be where you are, or you should be where they are, or they, you know, you're better than them, or you're worse than them, and all that stuff. Like, just have some compassion for each other and help each other to get over the different humps. There's things you will see that, because you don't have the injuries, there are things you see that other people won't see, and then there's things they'll see that you don't see. And if we have compassion for each other, we won't automatically assume that the other person just wants to pull us down or attack us. We won't automatically pull ourselves down or attack ourselves. We'll have compassion for myself, for ourselves, and for others. Yeah. So many of you have been harsh on yourselves, and you've also been pretty hard on everyone else too. Right? And honestly, you've got to give that up. That's not loving. It's not loving self or the other person. So we need to give that up and find out our reasons why we do it and give them up. Give them up by processing through them and releasing them. Yeah. Anyway, that's the main thing I wanted to talk to you about being my loving self in the world. You've got plenty of opportunities in this lovely world that God's created to be yourself. And the world, like as we said in the first group, the world's in a bit of a mess from perspective of love, right? So this gives you more opportunities than you'd ever have if the world was in a good place to actually express your loving self. There's a whole lot more opportunities as a result of it. But it's going to require some of these qualities in order for you to do it. That's all. Yeah. So have fun with that. Being your loving self. And don't invest in how people respond to you. If you know you're doing the right thing, and you know you're doing a truthful thing, and you know you're doing a loving thing, then do it. Don't worry about whether people are going to be angry with you, attack you, belittle you, or approve of you, or like you. Don't worry about any of it. Just go and do it. If you feel the motivations of those other motivations, you'll get some responses which will trigger some of the addictions and help you see more of your facade. That's good. It's going to be a good thing to see those things. Well, I'd like to finish the discussion now. So that's the end of our discussion about being a loving self in the world. What we'd like to do, though, is I'd like to invite Mary up. And we want to just share with you a bit about our plans and stuff. And also ask you for some feedback if we can. Is that all right with you?
Yep.
So I'm a bit over time now, and this might take about 15 or 20 minutes, but we should be finished by 4. And what I thought is after 4 o'clock, would you guys like to have a photo, a group photo?
Yes.
Yes? So if you would, then what we'll do is we need about 10 minutes afterwards to get the place ready, but what you could help by stacking up your chairs in groups of 4 and putting them right up the back in that corner. Over in that corner there. And if you could do that before you just go out, if you go out for 10 minutes, have a chat or whatever, we can do what we need to do to set up a proper thing here so that all of us can fit in the shot, and we'll try and set up the shot, and then we'll invite you back in. Is that all right? But let's first talk to Mary.
Before we do that, can we just say how amazing has this guy been? He hasn't been feeling 100% this week, but you wouldn't know it in terms of what he's given.
Yeah, got some things to work on when I get home. Yeah. All right, the thing we wanted to talk to you about was our plans for the future. The main reason why we'd like to talk to you about them is because we're still in a process of adjusting next year's timetable for us, and we feel that having three of these groups in a row sort of leaves you in an overloaded, emotionally overloaded condition.
It's pretty, you're feeling like you've just had the Developing My Will, just done this one. How's that feeling?
Pretty overloaded with what to do without any time to do it.
Have you even like, Will, oh my gosh, and now we're into the next thing.
Yeah.
And if we do that again next year, we just felt like, forget about it, you'd be in overload the first day.
Yeah. So what we're thinking of doing is this. We'll still have group number three of this year, which is the law group, understanding God's loving laws. Because a lot of the reason for that is that there's people who are already booked and who come from overseas and so forth, so we don't want to stop that from occurring. And we've already told the venue that we'll be having it, so you know it'd be unloving to cancel it with the venue. So we'll do their group, and then we thought we'd have a year off of groups, a whole year. So you have less financial things to worry about with regard to that year, getting time off and all those other things. But during that year, what we're going to do is in our studio, we're going to do every presentation we've given so far up to that point.
So for every hour of new material presented,
we're going to do 4 hours of Q&A on that material in our studio. Does that make sense? Does that sound all right? And what that does is it gives you opportunities, and this is what we're going to suggest to you. If once you start working on different things, you'll have different questions, right? And then you could send in those questions, and we'll put them in the FAQ channel, and we'll choose what we feel are the most important questions, and some of you have the same questions, obviously, so we'll sort of amalgamate things. And then myself and Mary, and also some others that we'll get at different times, we'll do, answering those questions. So for each 1 hour group, there will be a 4 hour Q&A. Now what that means is that, say for the first group, you know how we had right at the beginning, there was like the introduction talk? Well, there will be a 4 hour Q&A for that talk, in addition to the two talks that you had from the first group. So that means that for that particular session, you have 2 hours of the group itself and 4 hours of Q&A to look at, which will help you come to an understanding of things you might not have understood at the time. And then the second and the third and so forth. But we won't be having a 4 hour extra on the Q&A itself, if that makes sense. It's only on the new material that we presented. If we do it that way, we'll probably have time to do the entire, so all the stuff we've done in this year, all the three groups, we'll probably have time to do the whole four hours for each new presentation in those three groups. Right, so that'll give you a whole lot of extra information at your fingertips, able to apply, and it'll be there as a sort of a resource for anybody who wants to apply that material. Does that make sense? So that's what we're thinking of doing. We thought of a lot of other options, but none of them, all of them have their individual problems. And also, you know, we did think about having a group like this, but just Q&A. But the problem with that is that we only get to do 1 or 2 hours per new material thing. And on top of that, you know, there's extra costs available. You know, there's prices, costs, and you guys have got to get time off for work or whatever it is. And there's a whole lot of extra money going there. And so we thought it would be far more economical to do it this other way.
Doing it this way also allows people who live overseas, who don't have the chance to actually be here, to ask their questions and have them answered.
Yeah. So we'd encourage the people who are watching these material after the event to actually think about the questions that they personally had, and if they're not the same as the questions that were presented in the Q&A presentations, that they send those questions in on the FAQ channel and we can address. And the FAQ is just faq@divinetruth.com. So that's the address that you send all of the questions, and we'll sort through those questions.
When you send them, if you could write...
the group they apply to.
The particular presentation, so for example, being my loving self in the world, if you can write that before your question so that it makes it much easier to deal with all the questions, obviously.
Because that way we catalogue them into the actual group that you believe they apply to.
We might recategorise them.
We might recategorise them, but...
Yeah.
So that's our plan. Does that sound like feasible for you guys? And that basically means that next year we probably won't be having many or any public seminars for the whole year. That we are planning to do a trip overseas, but we couldn't do it this year because of how busy we are. And so it'll have to be next year. And that probably would be sometime May, sort of June next year. So in amongst all of these, we'll probably have a short overseas trip where we see some other people overseas as well. So that's our plans for the next year. In amongst all of that, of course, we're thinking of doing a second day of material next year at our studio, which will be sort of a mixture of the similar mixture that we've done in the past. So it'd be a mixture of discussion of pageant messages,
channeling,
personal feedback and other things like that. So those things will continue for one day of the week as well. And what we find is that generally, the most we can sort of manage is 2 days recording, 1 day editing. Now, there's possibility that Lena and Igor might not be editing next year for different reasons. And so, that'll, if that's the case, then it'll probably be me editing or someone else editing. So that means it will restrict how much we can actually do as well. So we'll just see what happens there and what transpires. But that's our goal for the next year. I think that's the main thing we wanted to share.
It is. I was going to
really get your feedback about whether
you think it's a good
you think
idea.
That's a good idea or not. And if it is, then we'll start making plans immediately after this group. So that means that all of your registrations, probably what we'll do is we'll change the date of the registrations.
Yeah, I need to investigate. So you
might
hear from me.
Because we don't know how Eventbrite actually works.
Yes. If I can change the dates, it depends. Well, I'd like your feedback on this. Would you like me to retain your registrations for the groups you're already registered for, even though they'll happen in a different year? Each of them will happen in a different year. Yep. So if I can, I'll do that. If I can't, then I'll have to issue something to everyone and say, look, I'm so sorry.
You need to re-register.
We've had to, delete the events and recreate them. But I think we should be able to change the dates. So you should be fine.
Now, we've already checked with the venue for the following year. So we'll probably have this venue again the following year.
So that's 2018.
And there will only be two presentations that year.
Yep.
It'll be the Understanding Sin and Its Causes and Removing Sin and Its Causes. That'll be, and one of those presentations will be February, March. There'll be two of the same course, February, March, and then two of the same course in November, similar to this one coming.
There'll be same time as this one, basically, that you're just at, and then same time as the
no,
one.
No, it's not the same time as this one.
Oh, yes. May, June, didn't you say?
No, it's February, March.
February, March, that's
February,
right.
March.
Longer.
Yeah. So there'll be a longer break.
Plans.
Yep. Longer break in between is basically what we're adding, trying to get. And I feel that will sort of lessen the workload. And then then there'll be a break of a year again so that you can catch up with that material and we can do a whole heap of Q&As on that material. And then in 2020, our plan, it's a long way ahead, but it's our plan, is to do three sessions
the
like we did,
three.
The three final three like we have this year. That's sort of our plan at this stage, which may be adjusted with or without notice, depending on what the circumstances are at the time. But that's our plan at the moment. And what we're hoping to achieve through that is to get through the entire cycle. And by the time we've got through the entire cycle, many of you actually may be quite well developed if you have used your will.
Well, that's what I was going to say. You have the opportunity. Doing it this way, there's a great opportunity to develop your aspiration, isn't there?
Yeah.
Instead of, you know, relying on, oh, there's another one, I'll just go and get my little
inspiration.
And avoid how I'm not developing my faith. And you can really take the opportunity to develop your faith, use your four tools. And if you do that, you will grow.
Yeah.
And that means you, each new group you come to, you'll be more ready for. Because we've designed them in such a way that if you do engage the material in one, you're more ready for the next one, and so on and so on. So, yeah.
The other thing I need to let you know is that we've decided to hardly do any recording between this group and the next group. So from now to November, we're looking at probably not doing any major recording except for a few training videos. The main reason why we're doing that is that we have a whole heap of training documentation to do, because we want to start gearing up for expansion of some kind, which means that we're going to have to train additional people and so forth. And we need to have all the procedures and everything in place and all the documentation in place to allow for that expansion to occur. And so what we're trying to do now is probably go through during that break period, besides my preparation of our preparation of the next group, we need to also do some training stuff so that we can train a whole group of people in how to edit our videos and also how to do events like this and a lot of other things like that. So that requires us sort of needing some time there. So that's probably how we'll be using our time in that period. We feel that will give you the opportunity to catch up a bit and go over some of these stuff without being so stressed about it and feeling under pressure. And it will help us a lot too, because in the long run, that means we have documented processes rather than all of the information in people's heads. We need to document a lot of processes so that we can get it all down on videos and that, and it's replicatable. So that's our general goal this year. So you won't hear much from us. There will be website updates, obviously, with all this material. And there will be some website updates with the new material when it comes out for the next group, you know, the outlines for the next group. And there obviously will be website updates from our transcription and transcribing, our translating teams and so forth. But there won't be much new material from us other than what comes out at this group.
Which is quite a lot, really, anyway.
It's already 120 hours of material after this group, which will be coming out, which you've already got 60-something hours up. 64 or 68 hours up, and there'll be some more coming up. Now, there might be an occasional channeling that gets in there and so forth, but we'll let you know on the What's New page about that. The other thing is that we're doing some little bits of training videos on how to use the YouTube channels so that you can find things easier. We're doing some training video on how to use the website, because we notice a lot of people still struggle with understanding how the website works. So we're actually doing a training video on YouTube about how the website works as well. And the reason why we've done that is because there's a huge amount of information there at the moment, 1,800 hours almost of videos now. And honestly, there's tens of thousands of pages of documents. And most people, or a lot of people, don't know how to access it. And we're trying to simplify that, but we can't do everything. And one of the things the website badly needs is a fully functioning search engine of the website itself. But that's going to require a lot of work to produce, actually. And I just don't have the time to program that. And at this stage, I haven't found a really good programmer who lives near me, who I can explain all my needs and requirements to, who can actually do the work either. There's a lot of programmers who think they know better than what I want, but I've got pretty clear ideas of what I want done. And a lot of times it's not what any programmer is used to doing. And so it's going to have to wait until I find somebody who can actually do the job. And there's a lot of data that needs to be entered. There's nearly 10,000 pieces of data that needs to be entered in a database to actually drive the engine, and that's going to take time to do. So that's what we're working on at the moment. So we're pretty busy, And that probably brings us to thanking you for your donations, because obviously a lot of this, getting a lot of this done depends on your donations. So it's so great that you've donated to us to get this venue sorted. We'd like to thank a few people if we can. You're right with that?
Yeah, go.
Yeah, what did you want
right.
to say?
No, it's all right.
We'd like to thank Raj and Suze for finding the venue for us, because it is a convenient venue for us, isn't it? Yeah, so, yeah. How are you coping? How are you coping with the bats? A bit smelly at night at a certain time? Yeah. I found if you air your
accommodation
between morning and lunch and close up after lunch, you're in business inside. But if you leave it till dusk, it can be a bit smelly inside, so just watch that. It is a problem. Apparently, it's a big problem for Noosa. It's worse in that corner where we stay. So, yeah, you know, probably don't notice it much over there. But, it is a big problem for Noosa at the moment, how they've got these very, very large bat colonies of 30,000 to 50,000 along the Sunshine Coast. And people are getting quite angry about it, interestingly enough, and triggering lots of emotions. And as a result, they're doing all sorts of things to make it worse. and it's a bit of an issue at the moment. But we'll see what happens over the next few years about it. In the end, we might come back and there might be like 100,000 there. We don't know.
Is there anything about the venue, stuff that you really love, stuff that's been difficult, anything in terms of comments or feedback?
Yeah.
No, just happy. Just good venue. Yep.
Food's all right.
Yeah, food's good. Yeah, that's good.
So I like being able to have your own kitchen and do what you want.
Yeah,
so good. Yeah, you know, that's an essential part of what we were looking for, having your own kitchen and so forth. Yeah. Rachel, you'd like to ask if you use a mic so that we can. Yeah.
I just wanted to ask about that. Was that the explosions going off last night? Was that a bat? Is that something to do with the bats?
Oh, I got no idea. Didn't hear any explosions.
Oh, right. It was great terror trigger.
Probably fireworks.
It's like we're all being attacked.
I'd say it'd be fireworks or something. Fireworks. Yeah. I think they've determined that if they scare the bats from where they are, they're going to go into multiple colonies all over the place, and they don't want that. It's better if they're all in a single place. So hopefully they don't distress the bats too much.
Yeah.
I think that's bearable, particularly a couple of times a year, not too long. The second group of people we'd like to thank is our two videographers at the front for this group, which is Kelly. and Cornelius. So Kelly's now filling up to speed training-wise. She's been training, so she's been in training. Corny's the expert, so he's the one that he doesn't think he is, but he is. And he's really good on it. And when Igor gets any other shot, he says, it's not as good as Corny.
But it's a big job for these guys. They're standing all day while we're in here. So, yeah.
Yeah, and they both volunteered their time. So, and obviously also paid for their own accommodation and everything, because we haven't had the funds to pay for all those things. There are donations up the back, donation boxes up the back to assist them with those costs. So please feel free to donate to them to help them with those costs, to defray those costs. Mm-hmm. And last group, it was Eloisa who did it in place of Kelly, because Kelly attended the group. So they have a swap over in the groups. Yeah. Of course, we'd like to thank Lena and Igor. Thanks, guys. There's a lot going on for them, right? In the mornings and the nights, but also during the session. Like, you can see Lena's surrounded by things.
She's tagging.
Cameras,
she's
tagging,
got two cameras.
All this stuff going on. There's a lot of processes that help us later for editing that she's doing. And Igor, of course, is always switching. You've got to be really on the ball with it. And to make a good production, he's got to be concentrating the whole time. And to concentrate for 5 hours, switching, making sure it's shot for the whole time can be quite exhausting too. So there's a lot involved, and Lena hasn't been feeling too good either this week, have you? So it's been a bit more difficult than usual this week.
You
a bit tired, yeah. A bit tired.
You're a bit tired.
Yeah.
Because remember these guys, especially Lena, Igor, Corny and Jesus, this is their second time through. And these three haven't been home. They've just stayed in between time doing different things that for the production and things like that. So it's a long time. Yeah. It's like a month.
And our job's only just begin now because as soon as we get home, I edit the outlines and then the guys start a few days after me because I've got to get some things ready for them. And once they will start, probably not this coming Monday, but the following Monday, they'll start editing. And that takes usually anywhere from 2 to 4 weeks of, you know, every day, for every work day, if you like, for 2 to 4 weeks. So we sort of think that we'll get out, that our plan is to get out probably by something like mid-July, the material that you now see, you've been involved in creating. So last time we were pretty good at getting out at the time we thought. We had a few teething problems in terms of working out how to do it and everything, but we've sorted those things out now, so you know it might be a little quicker this time. But we're also doing procedures and stuff, so obviously that adds to the process a bit. So we think it will probably be about the same time period, probably mid-July, that you'll see the recordings, these recordings, and be able to watch them again. And the groups are a little different as well, so you might be, you know, you might enjoy watching the other group as well. And the other group probably enjoy watching this one.
I was going to say that's the other thing that we'll be doing in between times is developing the material for the next group.
Yeah.
And predominantly Jesus, but I pitch in as sounding board and I have a few ideas. But that's a really big job, the next one, because we're talking about God's universal laws
in six days,
essentially, you know, 12 hours to sum that up.
Well, it was basically 16, but the way we were going to structure it, but yeah.
Yeah. It'll be slightly different, the format, the next one, but yeah.
There will be less group feedback, probably no group feedback in the next group. More focus on the actual material and really fascinating material, but of course we're just going to just barely scratch the surface of it. You know, our last, like 1900 years of life has been discovering God's laws. And what we're trying to do is just summarize some of that for you in a very, very short presentations on each subject, just so that you can get the flavor and the feeling of it rather than sort of understand it in a lot of detail. But you'll learn a lot of very interesting things if you come along to that group.
Mm-hmm.
I'd also like to thank Miguel because she's helped me a fair bit doing this outline. I had four bites at this outline and I did four different edits of it all. And I was never happy with it. And Mary would come back and I'd say, she'd read a bit of it and I'd go, I'm not happy with that. We ended up having to go through a bit of a process to be happy with it.
I think it turned out good,
hopefully
don't
it's
you?
Turned out all right for you. Yeah. And hopefully it sort of had some logical development and logical sequential development for you to follow because our first attempts weren't that good at that. Yeah, there's so much information, right?
Yeah.
And there's so much we'd like to share, but we've got to be very careful that we don't sort of go way, way overboard and not share the essentials with you.
And we really focus on the things that are actionable and applicable right now. For you guys, the simplest way to say the big lesson with the most impact, and so that you actually feel like you can grasp it, and you feel like you can go away and experiment with something.
Yeah. So we hope to make the next group just as interesting. I find the material in the next group more interesting than pretty much anything else. So aside from my interest perhaps in God, my interest in laws is probably higher than my interest in the human soul because the laws actually provide the framework and structure for how the human soul functions. And so the more you can discover about God's laws, the more you understand about the soul. Yeah, it's just fascinating stuff. So, yeah, we hope to present a lot of that or as much of that material as we can squeeze. So you might find a bit of information overload in the next group for those of you who attend. And lastly, we'd probably like to thank you guys again for your donations.
Yes.
Many of you have donated, not here, but, you know, via bank stuff and everything else.
Yeah, I really wanted to thank you all for that, because I know a lot of you have donated prior to attending as well.
Yeah. So, and some of you after as well, in the previous groups, have done after, so we'd like to thank you for that. There's also people overseas who haven't attended the groups who are actually donating the same amount as if they've attended the groups, which is wonderful, because that helps us do other things, of course. So we'd like to thank those people who have thought about doing things that way. And it just it, what it means is that we're able to continue doing what we're doing, and the way we're going at the moment, we'll be able to continue doing what we're doing, and hopefully grow it a bit, and also start sharing some of your donations with people who are helping us more, because that's been a problem in the past, and so it means there's a limitation that people still have to work and earn their own money, whereas if we can start sharing some of these donations with people because we're getting enough to survive ourselves, we can start sharing donations with others, and then we can have more people. And the more people we have, the more we can do, you know. So it really gets down to using your funds in the most wisest manner, most wise manner that we can. And that's what we're attempting to do. So we'd like to thank you for that, and your donations.
And thank you for your participation this week.
You've given a gift.
Yes.
Not only to yourself by being here, but to the world by sharing your feelings and being open and
being yourself,
asking questions and engaging the process. And you've shared in this creation. And it's wonderful that you've been open to do that. And it's wonderful that you've worn your heart on your sleeves a bit. You know, this is great. And also it helps other people who are listening to engage with the material more too.
It helps far more than when we just do stuff in the studio. That has its own benefits, obviously. We get through a lot of stuff together, we present a lot of material, but I see these as quite special opportunities when we are with various people, because you each bring your unique personality and your unique injury set, you know?
And therefore unique questions and unique things that we can address.
Responses and, as you answer the questions and interact with Jesus as he's speaking with you. A lot of people I know relate to certain ones of you more than others, and that's really helpful for them.
And it's also quite good even when you act in your injuries, because it gives me a chance to correct and show where the correction is and so forth. So thanks for being brave enough to do that. You know, that's a really good thing that you're actually assisting other people who have the same kind of feeling and the same kind of attitude to also look at the same kind of issue that you've had to address. So this is also very good and much, much better than many of you think at this point. You know, you feel embarrassed sometimes about what happened or whatever, but you don't need to, because it will illustrate to people what happens and what needs to happen and how love is reflected and how it isn't as well. So this, we need to understand the world's definition of love as much as we need to understand God's in some ways, don't we? Because we need to see the contrast. Mm. And this gives us an opportunity to demonstrate the contrast. Mm. So it's really, really good. Helen, you'd like to ask?
Down in her pretty skirt.
Going for a jog.
Yeah.
I'd just like to thank you for that gift of being your loving selves in the world.
Yeah, thanks, Helen. And if we go back to Denise.
Just to Denise.
To Denise and Darwin, sorry.
Yes, I also wanted to thank all of you as well.
Yeah.
It was just a wonderful gift. But I also would like to thank the musicians, Fab and Kate and Corny, for their wonderful gift. It was great.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks.
And, you know, that is an expense for them and time for them and so forth. So it's wonderful that they give you that gift.
That's a gift that they specifically wanted to give to you guys. It's not sort of, we facilitate it a little bit, but really it's their gift to everyone who
comes.
To
you directly.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
Fab.
Fab, there he is. Yeah. And then maybe on this side.
Maybe with the music thing, primarily this week, Kate, because... You know, I had an injury and Corny helped me out the other day, but Kate, just seeing her, you know, do that every day and then learn new material and try to stretch yourself. It was so good to watch her. So
exactly. So this week, Kate did some last week as well.
Yeah.
But Kate this week was here present as well as having to do quite a bit more.
So it was really
work,
nice to just, you know, have Kate do that, you know, because... Yeah. Well done, Kate.
Thanks, Kate. Yeah. And we'll have to discuss with you guys later if you want to continue doing that. That's fine, you know, whatever you'd like to continue doing there. We've got one more group this year and then break for a year and then two after that. So we'll talk to you about the dates and all those things later. Okay.
Yvonne
had a hand up, so you'd like to...
Just a little question. Come end of July, what's the easiest way for us to update our hard drives?
Just send them in to us and we're happy to update them. I think last time I updated about 20 or so. It's so easy for me to update them. So, yeah, just send them in.
Yep. If you can... do we want to have postage or just...
Best if we have some return postage or if we can leave them in our letterbox for those who live near us. Yep. But if we have some return postage, that helps.
And in fact, you can just leave them in our letterbox.
Yeah.
If you want, and just drop me an email to say it's there.
As long as you're okay with someone maybe coming along at some point and taking from your letterbox. Because, you know, let us know that
by
it's email.
Yeah.
If you do that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll update those for you. And for those, obviously, who are international, we have changed the layout of the drive. So the international people will see that reflected in their synced copy. So the international people will have a synced copy. And we're in the process of just putting some sort of layout instructions or a description of the layout of the drive so you can access, because most of you don't know, but there's not only videos on the drive, but the entire website's on the drive too. And the fast way of doing it is to access the website and then from the website you can access all the videos.
So it's an offline version
of the entire website with an offline version of YouTube, all on the same drive, right? So those of you who are international and if you've had your drives updated, what you'll need to do is you'll have to change your sync locations to match the new locations if the location has changed for your drive. So it might pay to just do a resync if you've had an update. Yeah.
Just a final note on the drives. When you drop them off, please let us know what sort of computer you have.
Mac or PC. Yep. We can also format the drive for a Mac specifically if you want that, but you've got to remember that it's not transferable to other devices if you do that. Whereas if we format the drive for NTFS in particular, which is for a PC, then you can actually plug the drive into the new smart TVs and play it straight from a smart TV and so forth. So you might find that that's more beneficial in the long run than watching it on a PC. All right, well, that brings us to the end of our day. Hopefully you guys have enjoyed yourself and learnt some things. But the real hope that we have, but we're not. We're not.
No pressure.
No
expectation.
No expectation is that you might actually want to apply some of it, and we see some changes and start rowing your own boats.
This is the big puff into your sails as you go out. Yeah. It's up to you.
To row.
You're gonna row.
Yeah, yeah.
Get out of the harbour.
Even if it's a tiny spoon you're paddling with initially, at least do something.
Building up the muscle so you can move up to something bigger.
Yeah. You imagine they're in the canoe paddling with a spoon. Probably not going to get very far, but you never know. At least you've started the process. Yeah. But let's not have any more comments. We would like to finish the session now. I've been talking for 4.5 hours now.
If we can maybe just thank Jesus again. Yeah. Yeah.
One thing we would like to say in closing is that many of you have come and sometimes have seen new faces and so forth. We would like to have spent more time with you personally, But the reality is our life while we're here is very, very busy, and we've been talking long periods of time. So it's actually not possible for us to spend much time individually with you. And we'd just like to apologise to you if you've sort of expected that, but it's not really possible given the circumstances and the situation. So we'd like to thank you for your patience about that as well, and you honouring my space for me so that I can keep doing it even under sometimes when I'm under a bit of pressure from my own personal emotional state. And so it's been nice that you've been able to give me that space as well. So thank you for that.
And we hope you feel welcome. It's lovely to see new faces as well as people we've known for a long time.
So, yeah. So welcome to those that we've seen.
Yeah.
All right. Many of you travelling home, some of you going back home overseas, have a safe journey home, and also enjoy yourself when you get there in terms of engaging your life with more of your loving will. And we hope to see some of you again come November. And if we don't, then good luck with watching the material and learning from that material on YouTube.